this video, we're going to work with the definitions of the box and product topologies. Remember that if you want to support the channel, there are several ways for you to do so. You can become a member on Patreon to get exclusive content and amazing mathematics merch. You can also make very small donations on Ko-fi, or you can visit our t-shirt store to get mathematics t-shirts. Now, the box and product topologies, the idea behind this is to get a topology in a product space. So we will have many spaces, many sets, x1, x2, and so on. They could be countable or uncountable. And the idea is to define a topology in the product space. And here we will again use the notation of an arbitrary product so that we can generalize this for countable or uncountable products. So we will say A in some index set J of all the x alphas. So we've done this before whenever we have two spaces, x1 times x2, and we were able to define a topology here with the basis b of products u times b, where u and b were elements in the corresponding topology. Let's call them tau 1 and b in tau 2. So we have products of elements in the topology of x1 and elements in the topology of x2. This set formed a basis, and then from this basis we could get a topology on this space. But now what can we do whenever we have an arbitrary collection? Well, the first definition is going to be immediately generalizing this one for any product. And this is what the box topology does. We have many sets, countable or uncountable, all depends on the set J where we are indexing the sets, and we want to define a topology on this product space. Well, the one that we're going to choose is the topology generated by these spaces. It's simply the product of open sets where each open set is on the corresponding space. So we take U1 in the topology of the first X, U2 on the second one, and so on. That is in the case, obviously, where J is a countable set, but if not, then it doesn't matter, it's just generalizing that to the continuum case. We have these spaces, and these spaces will give us a topology, and the topology is the box topology. It's immediately generalizing what we have in the case of two spaces, x1 times x2, to an arbitrary product of sets. But there is another way that we can define a topology. For this, we're going to need a few concepts. So first, let's talk about the projection mapping. We're going to define a function pi beta that will go from the product space onto the beta set. So this function takes an element in the product space. These elements are of the form x alpha. So they are just another tuple, like the ones we had in Rn, for example, but only that now we are allowing any cardinality for the alphas. So it takes these elements, and as a result gives us the beta component. So it's basically just a typical projection. And the other concept that we're going to need is the soft basis. So a soft basis is actually quite simple. It's going to be a set S, a subset of parts of X, so a collection of subsets of X, such that the union over all the elements in this set gives us the whole space. So if I find this collection, then from this we say that S is a subbasis for X, and it gives us a topology. So let's call it tau. This topology will be defined as an arbitrary union of finite intersections of elements of S. This set is a topology, and it's called the topology induced by the subbasis. So now that we have these two concepts, we can look at the following definition. So what we will do is, we're working on the product space, and so for each beta in J, we know we have the projection mapping pi beta. Now, pi beta goes from the projection onto expect. The inverse mapping, or the pre-image of pi beta, can take subsets of x beta, let's call them u beta, and give us elements in the product space. And so what we will do is take pre-images through the mapping beta of open sets in each of our sets. This will, for each beta in J, will give us a collection x beta, and then just take the union over all those sets. Well, this new set S is a subbasis for the product space, and the topology that it generates in this way, like the way we defined it before, we will call it the product topology. And this definition might sound a bit weird, so let's actually see what does it mean exactly. So one thing we have to know is that whenever we're working with a subbasis or with a topology generated by the subbasis, this part here in the definition gives us the basis for this topology. So we can take the set of finite intersections of n elements in S, and this gives us the basis. So let's see what the basis for this topology looks like. Let's call that basis V, the basis. And so, as I said, a set P is in this basis if and only if it's going to be a finite intersection of elements in S. So basically we're going to have subindexes, let's call them beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, and so on, a finite amount of subindexes, beta n, and B will be the pre-image for each of these beta of some collection of open set in each x beta. So it will be pi beta 1, the inverse of some u beta 1 intersection, the same for pi 2. And so on, I'm intersecting all of these subindexes up to the last one. U beta 1 will be an open set in the topology of x beta 1. Here should be u beta 2, and the same here. So u beta 2 will be an element in the topology of x beta 2, and the same uvn is going to be an element in the topology of x beta n. So we have a list of indexes, a finite list, and we take the intersection of all these pre-images. Well, this is what an element in the basis P looks like. Let's see what it actually looks like, because this is still not showing us a lot of information. Now, we know that elements in the product space look like this. So they're going to be of the form X alpha with alpha in J. This is going to be a tuple, so an ordered list. This element will be in B, if what happens? Because B is the intersection of all these pre-images, then each coordinate of X has to be in the corresponding set. So X beta 1 has to be an element in U1, X beta 2 has to be in U beta 2, this is U beta 1, and like this, all of these elements until we reach x beta n in u beta n. And what about x alpha, or alpha different than all of these, because this is just a finite list of indexes? Well, for these elements we don't have any restriction, because the only restriction that P imposes is being on beta 1, beta 2, and up to beta n for the corresponding coordinates of X alpha. But if alpha is different, then it's just free. So for all these alphas, X alpha will be an element in just the whole space, the corresponding space. So this shows us that B is going to be the product of U alpha, but where U alpha will be X alpha if alpha is different from beta 1, beta 2, and so on up to beta n. Then the elements in the basis for the product topology are going to be products of the whole set X alpha except for a finite amount of elements. So it's going to be the product of all the spaces except in a finite amount. That's the difference between the product topology and the box topology. In the box topology, we could have had an infinite product of open sets that were different from the whole space. Here, in the product topology, we cannot. We only admit a finite amount of elements in that product to be different from the whole set. So this immediately gives us that the product topology is coarser than the box topology. And the proof is actually very simple. We saw just now that every element here is a product of open sets that could be X alpha or just another one. So they are all elements in the box topology, but there are elements in the box topology that are not in the product. For example, the basis element product of U alpha with U alpha different from X alpha for all alpha. This element is in the box topology, but it's not in the product topology. But these two topologies are actually the same in the case when we're working with a finite amount of sets. So if J is finite, the two topologies are the same. So whenever we worked with X1 times X2, we could have been talking about either the product or the box topology. And now what happens, for example, if we have that each space X alpha has been given a basis B alpha? Well, from this, we get a basis for the product space, but with the box topology. And obviously, that basis is going to be just the product of all the bases. We'll continue working with the product and box topology in the following videos.